To complacency. Amen. Father of mercy, we thank you. Thank you for Christ Jesus. Thank you for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for your saving grace. For looking beyond all of our faults and giving us everything that we need. Lord, we thank you for your eternal protection and provision. Thank you, Father. Now, O God, we praise the Lord with compassion. Please forgive us our many sins. Cleanse us, O God, we pray, from all unrighteousness. Make us ready for your word, for the communicating and the hearing. Make us ready, O God. Father, we pray you maximize this message as you minimize the message. Lord, I'm behind thy cross and cover me with thy shed blood. It is in the name of Jesus I pray. People of God will join me and say, amen. A caution, a warning to complacency. Are we staying or are we? Okay, amen, amen. Well, good, they need to hear too. All right. Complacency. That's what this letter to the Church of Laodicea, this is the seventh letter in the book of Revelations, beginning with Ephesus. These are letters where, as Jesus sent by John, as he was out on the island of Patmos, Jesus met him, and with him comprised these letters to these seven churches. We have seven continents, right? To cover the whole world. And this one, this last letter, Church of Laodicea, is also a letter to the churches of today. There is no more letters. Amen. Seven is a numerical number of completion. Seven periods of time in the human life. Your body changes every 7 years. So that what you eat at 27 may affect you differently at 34. Because your body makeup changes every 7 years. There's seven colors in the rainbow. You don't get no more than that. Seven numbers in the musical bar. Amen. It is the number of completion. And so this is the conclusive letter to the churches and all other churches. And something different about this letter is that, unlike the other six letters, this letter, Christ has nothing good to say about it. He has nothing good to say. It starts with to the angel, more or less the messenger, the pastor. He says he introduces himself. And in every letter, Christ introduced himself. But the way he introduced himself is significant. He just don't do it haphazardly. He's introducing himself as the one that they need. As whatever your problem is, that's how I'm introducing myself. Okay? If you read the other letters, we study them in Bible study, we notice that how he introduced himself, it pertains to the problem that they're having. He says, these things say that, amen. That's the completion. That is the conclusion. That is the verification. Amen. The faithful and true witness. Amen. Let me go back and say the amen, that is the confirming Christ. Amen. That he confirms us as his children. He confirms our salvation. I don't need you to validate me. I don't need man to tell me where I am. Christ confirms our position in him. Whether it's too far gone or too, whatever the case may be, he's the confirming Christ. He is the amen. He is also the faithful and the true witness. He is the convicting Christ. Amen. Yeah, ain't nothing convict you faster in a court of law than a faithful and a true witness. Lord, it can twist the word all they want to, but I saw him means I saw him in any language you speak. I saw him. He convicts us when we're wrong, just as he confirmed when we're right. Aren't you glad about it? Then he introduces himself as the beginning of the creation of God. Amen. That is the conclusive Christ. It all starts with him. it all ends. The book of Colossians says all things are made by him, through and for him. The conclusive Christ. Completeness. Why is he introducing himself like that to this church? Because they have become complacent. We'll find out that they think that they're in a good place. And they are not. Are we all right? Look at it in verse 50. It says, I know your works. And that's all I got to say about that. You look at the other churches, he said, I know your works and how you've done this. If you go back and read these other churches, he says, I know your works and how you've done this and you've done that. And you know, nothing for them to say. I just know your works. You know how you get that relative that want to brag about or that friend what they, or who they are? And you just look at them and look, don't forget, I know you. Man, I say that there. I know you. So you might want to go tell that to somebody, because I know you. And that's what he said to the church. I know your works and nothing else. That you are neither cold or young. That describes the churches of today. We, along with all other churches, fall into complacency. We become apathetic to some of you. Not even interested in the things of God. Come sometime out of tradition and routine. There's a danger in that. We don't even like it when somebody just treats us apathetic. I never liked it when I invited a young lady out on a date and I said, where you want to go? It don't matter. What you want to eat? That don't really matter. I hate that. And there were times I wasn't going to have to deal with my friend. Never like someone who just did nothing really interested them about me, honey. So I know how God must feel, being the creator, being the nourisher and the sustainer of all life, and to see his creation look to him like nothing really matters. I go to church, but don't go to church. I go to Bible study, I don't go to church. Serve, I don't serve, whatever. And here you are, keeping me alive every day. With all of the deranged people, I'm not even know I'm walking around. The old saints used to say, through danger seen and unseen. And yet, you can act like you don't care. We all need to look at ourselves and wonder, to what degree am I? Am I too cold? Am I lukewarm? Because that's what the Bible tells me. God don't like that. God is saying, I'd rather you be straight out against me than just to go through the motions. Are we all right? You'd rather somebody just say, look, I don't like your cooking. Than to sit there and eat your food and fry it all up while eating. Just so you don't like it. There's a danger in becoming, and it's possible for all of us to become complacent. We become complacent, or we have the potential of becoming complacent with everything in our lives. Huh? Sometimes we don't even realize we're not giving our children the attention. Sometimes we realize we haven't visited mama like we should. We're not visiting our loved ones like we should, as if we know they're going to be there tomorrow. Often said in the black community, you can tell the one that didn't treat mama right. The one that showed up acting a fool at the funeral. They say it in our culture, in our community. And to some degree, that's true. When you know you haven't done what you should and what you could have done, not should have, but what you were able to do, it brings hardship to you. Right, you won't get that chance again. Amen. I learned that from my mother passing, and from that point on, every time I close a conversation with any of my relatives, and I don't know my children, but I always say I love you. I want to make sure. And I encourage anyone who's not doing it, don't let pride get in your way, man. And don't get complacent, ladies. If there's someone you love, tell them you love them. Tell them you appreciate them. Because we don't know what tomorrow will bring. Jesus said, here, you are neither hot nor you cold. He said, I'd rather you be one of them. Be my enemy or my friend. I don't need a friend in it. But be one of them. And as I said, we can all relate to this. I need to know if you're with me or you're against me. Just take a stand in my life. Then Jesus said, because you are lukewarm. Now, this is something that the people at Laodicea was familiar with. You see, where they were, there was their water had to be piped in. All right? About 40 miles out, their water had to be piped in. And so by the time they got to where they were, it was lukewarm. It wasn't necessarily cold, and it wasn't hot. And then the problem was, in those days, cold water, as in today, cold water was used for refreshing. Huh? When you get through sweating in the sun, you don't want a warm drink. Right? You want a cold drink. Huh? And then the hot water was used for medicinal reasons. Huh? When you want to cleanse something, purify something, you needed it hot. And so anything in between that, it becomes useless. And this is what Christ is saying for a lukewarm Christian or a lukewarm church. You are useless. To the point of nauseating. That's the word of God. He said, y'all see that? I will spew you or vomit you out of that. Means it makes me nauseous. Can you imagine being that person or that church? You don't want to be that church that make God sick, do you? Well, he's telling us what makes him sick. It's lukewarmness. Listen. What makes me lukewarm, Lord? What makes us so lukewarm? Verse 17, he says, because you say you are rich, increase with goods, and have need of nothing. Know not that you are wretched, miserable, poor, blind, and naked. Oh, we can relate to that. We can relate to that. You ever try to counsel with someone who was just lying to you? And you knew they was having a hard time. Amen. But they were looking you right in your eye, telling you everything all right. I had a friend one time, about a housewife, left him to the kids. And you can tell a man hurting from love. He don't comb his hair, he don't shave. He's standing half napping, beard napping. And when he come up to me, I asked him, I said, well, Doc, he come to my house. And I about 10 o'clock at night. And he's sitting there, I said, Doc, how you doing? I'm good. I look like, okay, you always look like that when you're good? Oh, come on, Rev. I said, no, if you come for me to talk to you, you got to be honest with me. You see? God is saying, I can't deal with you if you're lying to me. Tell me what it is. And then, there's something about God. You know, in Christ, when he met folk, we know he is the incarnate God. He already knows what's wrong with you. Something about us being honest to him. When Jesus would ask them, what would you have me to do? He already knows what they needed, but what you need me to do. God said, it makes me sick to hear you brag about stuff when I know your real condition. And even today, we get so caught up in trying to impress one another. We get so caught up with this grandstanding that sometimes we lie about our true condition. And I don't mean we have to go and tell each other, tell anybody else, but even to God. We get vague in our prayers. Lord, just touch, Lord, just touch. Just move, Lord, just move. Just have your way, Lord. Just have it. get suspicious, I said, get specific.
Amen.
Ain't nobody but you and him. If I have a lustful condition, Lord, deal with my lust. If it's stealing, Lord, help me not to steal. Ain't nobody there but you. Be specific. What you see where it is, God said you are telling the world one thing, but I know different. You ain't got to tell me you've been to tell me, yes, I need prayer. And that's all you need to know. You ain't got to get up here and tell the church everything you went through all week. Just tell them my family need prayer. And that's all the church needs to know. Sometimes I don't know what it is, but folks seem to want to gather somebody's sympathy and cry their way to heaven. I want you to cry all the way to heaven with you. Now, I ain't got time to cry. I got to give him praises. Because the Bible said he inhabits the praises. He lives, he dwells in the praises of his people. Not in the tears of the saints, but in the praises of his people. God is saying your biggest problem is you don't see your own needs. You think you need more money. You think you need more material things. You think you need that friend, that love. You think you need, he said, the problem is what you say. He said, what you say, and then go down and say, and know it not. What you're saying and what you know are two different things. There's some people, it don't matter how much life hardships beat them down. They will continue to brag like they got it all in control. I'm glad how life beat them down. They still find something else to do on Sunday.
Amen.
Besides going out to the house of prayer. No matter how hard life beat them down, they find something else to do besides people to buy or go out to a Bible study or sit around where the Word of God is being taught. They will find everything else. That's a powerful stronghold. When you know what I need is over there, but I'll find something else to do. I'll flip through the TV for 2 hours before I go down 15 minutes on my knees and pray. Seeking comfort through the television. All I got to do is go down on my knees. I know what I'm talking about. You ain't got to say amen. I know what I'm talking about. We seek everything else for comfort, for consolation, for guidance. And it's right there in front of us. God is saying, what nauseates me is you're saying this. And you don't even know that you are in this condition. Are we all right? That's your problem. That's your problem. You don't see your own need. You won't pray a prayer. Say, Lord, show me what I need. It seems like I need this. I know. But you said that in your word, that the way that seemed right unto a man, but the end there is death. So it seems like it. But Lord, I need you to show me what my need is. I've counseled so many. And it's been clear to me when they talk with me. I tell them, listen, what you first need to do is get a relationship with God. That's the first thing. And I'm talking not from what I learned in school, but from what I know.
Amen.
Until I decided to get a real relationship with him. One-on-one. Then other things will begin to unfold. You see? Other things will begin to come clearer to me. It's just like traveling. Those ones like the road trip. We like road trips, right? You ever been on that road trip in the 75 or 95 or whatever road you're traveling, and you hear a radio station with your song on. And you working them dials, they're trying to get that thing to come in clear, but it won't come in clear. But the closer you get to that time, the clearer that station come in. Or the closer you get to that tower, declare that channel come in. It's the same way with God. You cannot figure out what's going on in your life. You cannot figure out what he's doing in your life because you're too far away from him. We grew up in the country. I'll give you another example. We had no heater. We had no fireplace. We had a heater. And well, it got cold in Georgia. It got cold. And my older brothers and sisters, you know, they're a little bigger than me. They get up around close on something morning up to school. They get up around and heat a real slow. I can't get there. And I can't make it. They hog up all the heat. I'm back here. I can't feel no heat. Huh? But as soon as they get through with it and move out the way, I move a little closer. I feel a little better. Cold in your spirit. Now, I don't mean cold by being mean. But you're cold that you don't even feel the presence of God. You're cold because you can't even get into the praise service. You're cold because you can't even recognize what the word is saying. You're cold because you're too far away from the healer. So things are difficult. Things are difficult. You are left alone trying to figure out things. You are left alone trying to fight spiritual battles with physical weapons. And you'll never win. You'll never win. You'll never win a spiritual battle. I don't care if any of us are going through spiritual battle with our children. And we learned that backhand slaps didn't help it. Punches in the chest, pulling them by the ear, strap, that didn't help. Until we fought that spiritual battle with a spiritual weapon, we didn't see a change.
Come on now.
One of them I can testify is this plain old love. That's a powerful weapon. Especially when they expect a blessing and you give them a blessing. And you give them words of encouragement. Expect when they expect me a fight with your hand and you give them God's word. And that's more powerful than love. Love will cut through a wall of meanness. I know what I'm talking about. Humility. There can't be humility. The devil can't do nothing with a humble man. Did you know that? Peter knew what he was talking about. Remember, this is Peter said. Peter said, humble yourself. Remember that? Under the mighty hand of God. And he will do what? Exalt you. Listen who's talking. We know the history of Peter. Peter had to see to believe it. If Peter was pushed too far, he would fight. If he was questioned too long, he would cuss. All that document in Peter's history. But toward the end, he told us, all that I found out. Cussing didn't help. Cutting off a man's ear didn't help. Calling God out didn't help. The only thing helped is when I humbled myself. This is a man who was good with a knife. Saying, humble yourself. Under the mighty hand of God. Take notice. There are some weapons that you have. There's some things that you have. But sometimes we're relying on the wrong thing. Are we alright? I counsel you. Listen to what Jesus is saying. See, Jesus is not telling them this. All the things we just read. He says, well, you need a hot or cold. I'd rather you be hot or cold. You say you're rich. You say you have this. But you ain't got nothing. He's not saying this out of anger. Sometimes when you love a person, you got to tell them what they don't want to hear. And it's not because you don't love them. It's because you do love them. And you're telling them that because you don't wish any hard times on them. But you tell them, I see you going down a very bad road, a very dark road. And you're pretending like it's all right. I know it's all right because I traveled that road. Listen at the council now. He said, buy me gold. Buy of me gold. Listen, the reason, and I'm going to read that. I'm going to tell you why he mentioned those three items. He said, buy of me gold, tried and fine, that you may be rich, and white raiment, that you may be clothed. and that the shame of your nakedness do not appear. He said, and anoint your eyes with eye salve that you may see. Now, Laodicea was known for those three things. They were rich materially because of those three things. All right? They were known for, they were a big banking, they had a big banking system. Yeah. Yeah, they had an extravagant banking system, and everybody benefited from that banking system. They were known for that. They produced a black wool. They produced a black wool. And so that was obviously rare in those days. So they were prosperous in that. And then they were known for their medicine, particularly their eye salve. They were known, folk would travel miles and miles to go to Laodicea for good eye medicine. So that's why Jesus basically saying, put your goods up against my goods. Up against mine. And he said, see, you got yours and you're still naked. You got your blackboard and you're still naked. You got your banks and you're still poor. You got your eye salve and you're still blind. He said, try what I got over here. Let me talk with you, man. You got your car and you're still spiritually, you're walking. You got your money, but spiritually you're broke and impoverished. You have all the insight into the city, bread in high places, but spiritually you don't see Satan coming in your own house. We need spiritual enrichment. Please, please come back, those who I'm talking to, come on back to the Word of God. And I'm not talking about any routine. Come back with a vigor, with a desire to learn more. You have not learned it all. You don't have it all. You don't have enough. How do I know you don't have enough? Because you still have that spiritual battle that you have not won yet. Just look at that. The empty seats in here. And I know, starting with me, everybody in here, got somebody in your heart that you want sitting in this church right now. So that tells me you still got battles to fight.
Hallelujah.
You got somebody in there you desire to be in this church, not just in here, but serving. They got gifts to say. They have ability to help the church. And they're not here. That tells me you got some battles to fight. Don't get tired. I know you get tired, but don't give up. We all need time.
Amen.
We all should be encouraging one another.
Amen.
Huh? Encouraging one another. Because in this church and the other church, ain't nobody talking about the other person.
Amen.
Be careful.
Amen.
And if you think you know, you be careful.
Amen.
You were down in that family about their child, about their loved one, you better watch your family reunion. Then you left with nothing to say. You put your own self in that position. Hmm?
Amen.
We all have uncharted waters that we have not sailed. We all have battles that we have not yet conquered. And because you may have conquered a couple of them, now you want to sit down. The battlefield is still hot, people. It's still hot. There's so much more in this word. There's so much more that I'm still learning. Yeah. There's so much more for you to learn. This is your call. You come on back. Pick up your weapon. Dust it off. Shine it up. Come on, get on back in there, fight. This could be a church, not just where folk meet every Sunday, but this could be a church that impacts lives on a daily basis. That's the kind of church I want to stand before God and say, that's where I was. I want to brag about the 200-member choir. I want to brag about all the baby grand piano and all this stuff going on. Lord, we touch lives. Help us, Holy Ghost. Listen, he said, do all this, and then watch this. Jesus says, as many as I love, I rebuke and I chasten. Yeah. There's going to be some things you got to go through. Huh? But be zealous. Therefore, repent. Be zealous. Go through it. If God got to chastise you, get you back in, Lord, I'm glad you got me back in. Well, I may come in limping a little bit, but I'm back in. What the little girl say on the move, I may be ugly, but I'm free. I'm free. He set me free from my bound. He set me free from my bondage, and I'm thankful. I don't have all the friends I used to have, but I'm thankful. I don't wear all the jewelry I used to have. I don't have the clock I used to have, but I'm grateful. And if I die tonight, be with the Lord. Jesus said, I'm standing at the door, and I'm knocking. I'm knocking. You see that? No matter, I don't care how mad you've been, I'm still knocking. I don't care how much you turn your back on me, I'm still knocking. I don't care how you sat down and got lazy on me and let the slothful spirit take control, but I'm still knocking. I'm still knocking. Don't let it knock too long. Open the door, he said. Come on in, have a meal with me. Have mercy, Lord. To him that overcome, you got to sit in the throne. You can sit down and be in the Father. Year after year after year. Listen, complacency can be deadly. Think about complacency can keep you at bay. And you're not realizing you're losing so much. And before you realize you're lost, it's too late to get it back. Complacency will cause you to feel sorry for a long time. Somebody know what I'm talking about. You, Lord, if I wish I had another chance. Like the prodigal son, I wasted on riotous living. Don't you know the only thing that comes after waste is want? That's why we tell them now, when we get older, we tell them, don't waste your youth. Just being able to pop up out the bed in the morning, that's value right there. That ain't gonna last long. Huh? Looking in the mirror and see all the smooth skin, that ain't gonna last long. Enjoy it while you can. So to get your woman, you can eat anything you want, not even worry about a blood pressure check. That ain't gonna last long. Tell them don't waste your youth being able to get out and run around, play ball, whatever you do. Just get out and have fun and come back home and take a shower and maybe get out again. It ain't gonna last long. I'm gonna go walking right now in the best shoes they got. In the best athletic shoes they got. You put some of us on about a 5 mile walk and pick us up at 4. Something that the body tells us that we're fading. We're decaying. This earthen vessel is passing away. So don't waste the thing. Don't waste your gift. So many have wasted an opportunity to serve God. So many of us have wasted opportunity to glorify God with our gifts. And then when the troubles of life or hardships or help, whatever it is, begin to take that gift away, now you want to use it. Let's be careful. Complacency will rob us of some good times. Complacency will rob you of some peace in your life. But Jesus says, I'm still knocking. Oh, you've gotten complacent. You don't fellowship with me like you used to. And you don't take into account the opportunities to serve like you used to. But he says, I'm still knocking. Every day that God gives us to witness, whatever you're lacking in, God is still knocking. I'm glad that he is one that loves me in spite of. Because you got to show enough love of somebody. If you stand at the door and knock, after they keep on rejecting you, bring it to your remembrance that God still loves us. And it's not for me or anyone to stand here in judgment of you. But I'm here to encourage you to go ahead and open the door. I'm here to encourage you that if you know God has been knocking on the door of your heart. And I'm not just talking to the saved folk in here, or the unsaved folk, but I'm talking to the saved folk. You see, you might be saved, but you're not serving like you should. You might be saved, but you're not sacrificing like you should. And God is still knocking at the door of your heart. And you're right. The benefit of opening the door is in the scripture. He said here, whatever you do for me, it will not go in vain. Ain't that enough to open the door? Whatever I do in service to the Lord, it can bless my grandchildren. And you're right. He told Israel, I'm not delivering you because of you, but for my servant David, because I promise him, I will take care of you. I'm going to let you cross this desert. To have inheritance to leave to your children. Oh, if you can leave him the promises of God, I'll tell you there are some things that your money won't be able to get them out of. There are some conditions that material things won't be able to do for him. How many of you know it ain't all cracked up what it is? There was some dark pain in my life. There was some hardships in my life. There was some times that in my bachelor pad I began to sing the old song. Began to give God praise. I remember what my uncle sang. Remember what my daddy sang. It lifted my spirit. He gave me some hope. Thank you. Nazareth. He didn't have to go to Jerusalem. Somebody said he could have stayed in the country, or he could have stayed in the wilderness, but he went down to Jerusalem. He could have taken him to the jail house, took him from the jail. He let him step a shoulder, walk on his shoulder. The Bible said he could have called more than 12,000 because he could have been of age. I found out in my mathematical studies and theological studies, one legion in the Roman army consisted of 6,000 soldiers. 6,000 times 12,000 by 7.2. He could have called more than 7,000 soldiers just to deal with that.
I'm a one, he woke you
sacrifice is that 1 year. We don't want to open the case. Those who need to know without the office of safety. Let's know if you're safe, know you're not the same. But perhaps you need prayer. You need to think, just call in prayer.